Days.
Good.
Good. How's everything with the doctor?
Okay.
Good.
Did you tell your aunt about me?
I did.
What'd she say?
Well, no, I didn't. My mom's gonna tell her. So, hopefully she tells her soon.
Brother Rick, are you here? Can you bring that right up here? Not to get you ahead of time. Well, it's Pentecost Sunday. If you've never been to Pentecost Sunday in the Pentecostal church, you're in for a blessing. Amen. Come on, would you stand up? He's going to blow the shofar, and let's give out a shout. Hallelujah. Oh, Thank you. This is a song that Pastor Elena wrote. I've waited for this day. I've waited for your hearts to be ready. I'm ready to pour out in this place. Open your hearts, lift your hands, lift your voices, and I will pour out my spirit upon this place afresh and anew today. Hallelujah. Fire falling, Pastor Elena wrote this song. worth more.
There's nothing. There's nothing worth more. Nothing can compare.
There's something has to break.
Something has to break.
feel like worshiping the Lord. Amen. Come on, revival fire. Somebody's hand and put some fire. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, happy Pentecost Sunday. Amen. You start the blaze in this place, and it all starts in worship. So it's a special day, but it's been a special week. Do you know that this week, Duck Gardner Day?
Yes,
it was. Amen. The town of Binghamton declared Duck Gardner Day. So I sent him a video, said, I dig the duck egg. My wife is coming to bring the announcements.
Amen. Well, many have asked, how are you doing? And you know what? We all have those days that you feel unplugged. That doesn't make it that God's not doing his work. It just means that I need to do mine. Amen?
Amen.
And on Facebook, I had put on a thing where you see this mother dog, and evidently the babies had been born in some sort of area that then collapsed. And you see the mother dog just trying so hard to dig and get those babies free. Just digging and digging and digging. And then this gentleman comes along and he helps, and you're watching, you're waiting with great anticipation. And finally, one by one, the puppies come. And as we were singing this song, I had said in the prayer room, I feel like I'm on empty. Not that I don't have the spirit, I just feel exhausted. But you know what, I kept praying, Lord, keep filling me. And it just kept me thinking about that video with the puppies and the mother dog digging and digging and digging. Do you realize if you love something and you want something, you gotta work for it? Do you know sometimes you gotta dig? Do you know sometimes it takes work? And sometimes you feel even more tired digging? But in the end, when you see those puppies, in the end, when you feel the Holy Spirit, it is so worth it. So if you're sitting here and you feel like I don't feel indifferent, then you just gotta dig a little bit deeper. You gotta dig a little bit harder. And you can't give up, amen? So that's your word for today. Praise the Lord. If this is your first or second Sunday with us, we're so grateful that you're here, amen. And we hope that you all received a welcome package. And if you didn't, please let us know before you leave. Discipleship class number 10 will be next week, and then we start membership class. So if you've been coming here for at least 3 months or more and you wish to become a member, we will be blessed and look forward to that time. Save the date, it's in your bulletin. June 5th is when we're gonna clean up the church. It's mainly, Dan says, for men, but I don't know if that's necessarily true. But guys, there's painting to be done. There's painting in the kitchen to be done. There's painting and scraping in the sanctuary to be done. There's painting on the roof to be done. So if you are available, this is God's house. We cannot neglect it. We will answer to that. So please, please mark the date. Be here. This is your church.
Women can do
windows. Women can do windows. I'm sure we'll find things to do. Don't worry. Amen. And if you would like a recorded copy of today's message, please fill out the envelope at the hospitality table at the foyer. So, amen. Let's bless the Lord.
Amen.
Praise God. Father, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, that when we're on empty is when you're on full. When we're weak is when you're strong. So I'm in the best place I could be. And I pray, Lord God, as you continue to fill this place, and as we continue to dig for the deeper things of God, as we continue to recognize it's not just Jesus, but God and the Holy Spirit. When we get to that place where we desire all of you, Father, that's when, Father, we will reach that deep ground that we all so need. Father, have your way today, I pray. Let it come, Lord, with grateful, appreciative hearts, Lord. And as we give right now, let it be that same mindset. And all God's people said,
amen.
Well, good morning. Are we all in agreement?
Yeah.
We all in agreement.
Yeah.
You want that power?
Yes.
Hey, if God responds to hunger.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
You know, today, you're watching the young people, and I was watching the kids here, and you know, the altar is a perfect place for them.
Amen.
It's the perfect place for them. Because it's amazing what you'll hear up here, and it's amazing what will happen up here.
Yeah.
Amen? So, let's go to prayer. Father, we look to the God of the house. We know that there are those who are not here today. They're in the hospital. Lord, they're not feeling well. But we say, fire fall right now in Jesus' name. Fire fall. Fire fall. Can we give them a little praise? Because the fire's going to fall. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Fire fall upon them, Lord. Fire fall upon them, Lord. For empowering, for encouraging. And I thank you that Lord, this word is going to break out. It's going to break out over this pulpit. And it's going to break out over us. So asking, Father, that, Lord, you would fill Pastor Dan as he shares this word with a double portion of fire, oh God. And thank you that this word's going to be the word that went out on Pentecost today. And the response will be, what must we do to be saved? What must we do to be settled? What must we do to be blessed, Father? Lord, I thank you that this word is just not going to go over our shoulders, but it's going to go into our hearts. And it's going to prick our hearts, Father. And it's going to cause us to say, what must we do to be saved? So I thank you for the hunger that's here today. And I thank you for the fire that's here today. And I thank you for the healing, Lord, for everyone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. What, is there any doubt what today is? Amen. You know, I used to meet with a group of pastors for prayer, and I reminded them one time that, don't forget, Sunday is Pentecost, and they looked at me like with a blank look on my face, on their face. Well, guess what chapter we'll be looking at today?
Acts.
Turn to the book of Acts, and a lot of times I find some obscure verse that has to do with Pentecost, but today I'm going to stick with Acts chapter 1, verse 12 through 15. And then Acts chapter 2, 1 through 4. Can you feel the fire in here?
Amen.
I came down yesterday to turn the air conditioner just so it wouldn't be overwhelming, but we want it to be overwhelming. Amen?
Amen.
Acts chapter 1, starting at verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. As a matter of fact, some of the people that were here at prayer Wednesday, I asked as many as could come, let's crowd into the upper room this morning before prayer and cry out for the Holy Spirit. So thank you for those who did. When they entered the city, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. That is Peter and John and James, Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James. These were all one mind, were continually devoting themselves to prayer along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. At this time, Peter stood up in the midst of the brethren. A gathering of about 120 persons were there together. Chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. That's all 120 of them. We're all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues of fire distributing themselves as they rested on each one. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterances. Oh, these are such familiar verses to us Pentecostals. Very familiar. Pentecost Sunday. It's an exciting day on the Christian calendar. The day when the Holy Spirit came and gave birth to the church and endued the church with power. And it's my heart today that we encounter a revisitation of the Holy Spirit through a Pentecostal experience. not merely a recognition of an annual event on the Christian calendar, but a rekindled passion. Some of us need that today.
Yes.
We need a rekindled passion for God.
Yes.
We need a rekindled passion for the work that He's called us to perform. Maybe it's going to be a first-time experience for some of you. Maybe it's going to be a renewal for the rest of you. Whatever it is, we're asking for God to come in a supernatural way.
Yes, amen.
And I was speaking with Pastor Brian this week, and I told him my prayer. This is my prayer. For those of you who are very faithful to church, you're here every week.
Yes.
You're performing some kind of ministry, but it has become a routine. Uh-huh. It's just something that you do. You know what to expect. You already got planned what you're going to do after church. But it's my prayer that you would leave this place on fire for God today.
Yes.
Pentecost is not a denomination, as some people think. It's not just a one day of the year. It's not a heritage that gets passed down from generation to generation. Everybody has to get it for themselves. It's not just for this church. It's not just for City Church. It's not just for Calvary's Love. It's not just for Two Rivers. This experience is for the Baptist. This experience is for the Methodist. This experience is for the Holiness. This experience is for the Nazarene. It is for the church. Hallelujah. You are in a Pentecostal church.
Yes.
We are Pentecostal, and I'm so glad of it. We are Pentecostal not by birth, not by upbringing, not by heritage, not by culture, not by osmosis, not by rules, not by regulations, not by tradition, not by religion. We are Pentecostal by, here's my title, an act of God. The subject of Pentecost, the subject of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the subject of the gifts of the Spirit along with speaking in tongues has divided the body of Christ today.
That's it.
And it's ironic because the church starts here in Acts chapter 2 when the church was in unity, when they were in one accord.
Yes.
Pentecost was the result of unity. And now, Pentecost seems the reason for disunity. An act of God found the church in one accord. But over the years, the acts of men find the church in discord.
Yes, yes.
They get divided somewhere between Bethlehem, Calvary, and Pentecost. We get divided along those lines. Bethlehem is God with us. Calvary is God for us, but Pentecost is God in us.
That's right.
Many today have been to Calvary for pardon, but they have not been to Pentecost for power.
Yes.
They've been to Calvary for forgiveness, but they've not been to Pentecost for fire. So 10 days have gone by since the ascension when Jesus went back into heaven. And his disciples are waiting for a promise that he told them about before he left. They didn't know what to expect. And many times we come to church, even in this church, we come and we pretty much know what to expect.
Yes.
We do this, we do that, we pray this, and this happens, and that happens. And today was a little different. Pastor Elena just lost all control.
Yeah.
I love when that happens. But God loves to do the unexpected. He's not going to move in the usual way. He's not going to move when we do everything that's expected. He's going to move unexpectedly. He loves to do the unexpected. The church was not birthed in routine. It was birthed in the unexpected. It was birthed in the supernatural, not the natural. For 10 days, 120 people were gathered in the upper room. What were they doing? They were doing the same thing that we're doing here today. They were praying. They were worshiping. They were sharing the word of Jesus. And they were waiting. Why? Simply because Jesus told them to go to Jerusalem and wait. Oh, how many of us would do something simply because God told us? It doesn't make any sense. People are going to laugh. But I'm going to do it simply because God said to do
it.
They had heard his promise that they would receive power when the Holy Spirit came on them. They didn't know how long they would have to stay in the upper room. As a matter of fact, originally there were 500 people. 500 people went into the upper room. And it whittled down after the first day, a few left. The second day, a few more left. Nothing's going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. And by the 10th day, there was only 120 of them. But here they were praying, worshiping, waiting. They didn't know it was going to be 10 days. We can look at it now and say, well, it was just 10 days. They didn't know that. They didn't know exactly what it was going to look like. But they waited. They obeyed. They worshiped. You know why the book of Acts is called Acts? Because in its pages are recorded for us the acts of the apostles. All the things that the apostles did in that early church time period. But what happened in the upper room was not an act of the apostles. It was not the act of any other man or any other woman. It was an act of God.
Yes.
So here in chapter 2 is a recorded event that really changed the world. But it's the event that enabled the apostles to heal the sick. This is the event that enabled the apostles to raise up the crippled man, to raise up the dead. They didn't act on their own. It was an act of God. It says it came from heaven. God started the church. God created the church.
Yes.
God brought the church into being. It's His church. Many times I hear somebody saying, well, he asked me if I go to Pastor Dan's church. This is not Pastor Dan's church.
Right.
This is God's church. Amen.
Right.
It was an act of God that brought it into being. What happens here in Acts chapter 2 and what we have been praying for will happen in this church is something that cannot be worked up. It's something that cannot be manufactured. Today, we have acts of the church, but what is needed is an act of
yes,
God.
Yes, that's it.
The church has programs and all these things, well-meaning things. But more than that, they need an act of God, and we need an act of
yes.
God. When a tornado comes, when an earthquake happens, or a flood, or a hurricane, or lightning strike, what do we call it? We call it an act of God. Why? Because it's not man-made. It's not man-controlled. Well, Pentecost is an act of God in which He sends a mighty downpour of the Holy Spirit to those 120 yeah. gathered in that upper room.
Yeah.
And verse 2 starts out with these words, and suddenly.
We zone in
on that word a lot. It was just another prayer meeting, and suddenly.
Yes.
It was just another service, and suddenly.
Yeah.
It was just another Sunday morning at Crossroads of Life, and suddenly another Pentecost. Hallelujah. That's how God acts. That's how God works, suddenly. You think it's not coming, you've been praying for it, you've been waiting for it, then suddenly He shows up. Hallelujah. It happens suddenly. It's an act of God. Your world can look one day, one moment, and suddenly everything changes. Your thinking changes. Your outlook changes.
Yes. Yes.
Your condition changes.
Yeah.
Your situation changes.
Yes.
By an act of God. The walls of Jericho, you remember that story?
Yes.
The walls of Jericho looked exactly the same. After Israel had marched around them for 13 times, nothing happened. I wonder what they thought on the 10th time. I wonder what they thought on the 12th time. I wonder what they thought on the 13th time. We're doing this for nothing. Nothing happened. Then suddenly the walls came down. That's how God acts. Suddenly, hallelujah. In 2 Kings, Elijah and Elisha are walking along and talking together. Nothing out of the unusual. And then suddenly an act of God where chariots of fire and horses of fire appear and separate the two of them. And Elijah goes to heaven in a whirlwind when it happened suddenly. It had Elijah thinking, what was that? Malachi 3:1, I love this verse. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to His temple.
Yes.
That means they have been seeking Him. We don't know how long. But they were seeking him, nothing happened. They were seeking him, nothing happened. They were seeking him, nothing happened. Then suddenly the Lord that they were seeking came to his temple. And that's what happened on Pentecost Day. Suddenly there was an act of God that brought the power of the Holy Spirit to the church of God.
Yes.
Pentecost is an act of God. The act of God came in a sensational way. It came in a sudden way. It came in a supernatural way. The act of God came in the form of, number one, sound.
Yes.
Sound is what? Something heard. Look at verse 2. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind. The noise that they heard was an act of God. It was a violent blowing noise. It was not an actual wind. It was a supernatural sound of wind. It was not the sound of a gentle breeze, but it was the noise of a violent wind, like the roar of a stormy sea or the sound of a tornado. Those who have heard the sound of a tornado say that you'll never forget it once you've heard it. People often report that a tornado sounds like a freight train in the middle of your living room. For I can hear the thunder in the distance like a train on the edge of town. An act of God is something that can be heard. Now imagine 120 sitting together, believers. You've prayed together. You've worshiped together. And then you hear this sound. When they began to speak, what happened? You can hear it.
Yes.
Tongues. Listen to this. Tongues is an act of God. The silencing of tongues is an act of man. We want an act of God.
Yes.
There came from heaven a noise. Where did it come from?
Heaven.
We don't need any more noise from Washington, D.C. We don't need any more noise from the Democrats. We don't need any more noise from the Republicans. We don't need any more noise from Wall Street. We don't need any more noise from the protesters on the street. We certainly don't need any more noise from Dr. Fauci. We don't need any more noise from Hollywood. We don't need any more noise from the professional athletes. What we need, and what the church needs, and what America needs, and what the world needs, is more noise from heaven. Somebody give God praise. It's an act of God that can be heard.
Yes.
This act of God came in the form of, number one, something, the sound, something heard, and number two, sensation. Something felt. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. It was a sensation that they all felt it. It was an awareness that God had shown up.
Yes.
It was an awareness that God was in the house. He filled the house with his presence. We sang that song, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. When you came into the sanctuary today, you can deny it all you want, but you felt it.
Amen.
When that shofar sounded this morning, you can deny it all you want, but you felt it. You could feel God. When we lifted up our voice in worship, you could feel the Holy Spirit in this place. He has filled the whole house where we are sitting, and I want you to know today, God is here.
Yes.
What a sensation it is when you feel it, though.
Yes.
You may not feel it today, but God is here. But man, when you can feel it, what a sensation that is. God is here. Like the tabernacle, when the presence of God came in that pillar of fire, the people in the wilderness knew it. They sensed it. The Holy Spirit is something that can be felt. The Holy Spirit is something that can be sensed if you have enough spiritual sense to sense it. He came to the house where they were sitting, and he filled it with his presence. In 2 Chronicles, I love this verse, and we preached on it before. Chapter 5 says that there were songs of worship, many voices, singing loudly, loud music, many instruments. They were raising their voices and praise the Lord. This was no quiet church. The church has always been Pentecostal. They were raising their voices and praising the Lord. Then suddenly, the temple of the Lord was filled with the cloud of His presence. And the Bible says that the priests could not even perform their service because of the cloud. For the glory of the Lord had filled the temple. He filled the temple with His presence. He filled that upper room with His presence. And He fills this place today with His presence. This act of God came in a form of sound and sensation, and the third thing, sight. Something could be seen. You look around here today, we got torches of fire. You all saw it. Something that can be seen. Verse 3 says, and there appeared to them tongues of fire distributing themselves, and they rested on each one. It appeared to them tongues of fire. It appeared to them. That means it appeared to their eyesight. They saw it. They saw tongues of fire resting on each person. And when you are in a spirit-filled church, I'm going to warn you ahead of time, all too late. When you're in a spirit-filled church, you are not only going to hear things that you might not hear in other churches, you not only feel things that you might not feel in other churches, but you're going to see things that you won't see in other churches. Hallelujah. Each one of them had a visual manifestation that seemed like tongues of fire. They each had their own individual fire. You know, you bring the fire in with you when you come.
Yes.
You can't wait to get here, bring the fire in with you. They each had their own individual fire. They each had their own individual anointing. And that fire and that anointing is over you today.
Yes.
It's available to you. If we were to pull the veil back and you could just get a glimpse into the spiritual realm, you would see over every single believer in this place, you would see tongues of fire that are available to each one of them. Like in Genesis, when it says that the Holy Spirit was hovering over the water. He was brooding over the water. He is over you today. He is hovering over you today. Every person in this room, there are tongues of fire hovering over you. There's a baptism of fire within your grasp today. And one thing that we know about fire, you can take one flame and start a forest fire with it.
Yes.
You can take one fire-baptized person. Can set the whole congregation.
That's it.
This one catches on fire, and this one catches on fire, and this one catches on fire. And the fire begins to spread. And the fire begins to spread until the entire church is on fire. And then when the entire church is on fire, they begin to notice it out there, and pretty soon the city starts to get on fire. A revival takes place in Binghamton. Hallelujah. But what we need is the church on fire, but it starts with one fire at once. It's not just about jumping and dancing. I'm all for that. But you can do that without the Spirit. What I'm talking about is an act of God.
That's right.
This act of God came in the form of sound, sensation, sight, and the last thing, saturation. That's something experienced. You know, many people, and you've experienced it too, when people come up and tell you that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not for today. It's because they've never experienced it. Because once you've experienced it, you can never deny that it's not for today.
That's it.
And I mention all this time, a lot, that experience will change your theology.
Yes. Right.
I mean, you can grow up in a church that doesn't believe in this until... You've heard the story. This is a tremendous story. Look it up on YouTube. It was on James Dobson's radio show, Focuses on the Family, about a Baptist preacher who lost his voice. You heard me share this before? I'll share it again really quick. He loses his voice, and the doctors couldn't tell what happened. Now, Focus on the Family is a relatively conservative radio program, right? And so they play the audio of this, and he had to leave his church because he could no longer speak. And he was gone for, I don't know, a year, 2 years, and they invited him to come back to teach a class. And he says, I can't teach a class because I can't speak. He said, well, we got that fixed. We're gonna put a microphone, you can just whisper. And so that's what he was doing. He came up and he whispered. And what is he teaching on that healing is not included in the atonement? He's trying to teach them that, you know, those Pentecostal nuts, there's no healing for today. Don't believe that stuff. And in the middle of saying that healing was not provided for in the atonement, something snaps and he gets his voice back.
Yes.
YouTube it. YouTube it. Yes. And the church started crying and they're clapping, and the experience will change your theology. Hallelujah. So it says, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, this is going to be some fresh manna for some of you. The house where they were sitting in was filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what it says. It was saturated with the Holy Spirit. So up to this point, the tongues of fire, watch this, were over their heads and available to each one of them, but it wasn't in them. Okay? It was over the head. In John 14, 17, speaking of the Holy Spirit, Jesus says that he abides with you. That's salvation. The Holy Spirit abides with you. Meaning now you're saved. But then, means some future time, he will be in you.
Yes. Yes.
See, salvation is the Holy Spirit with you. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit in you. He was telling them that what's going to happen in some future time. Right now, you're saved. Right now, he abides with you. But there's coming a day that he will reside in you. And that was the day of Pentecost. We believe in two works of grace. We believe that you can get saved now you possess the Holy Spirit. But the baptism of the Holy Spirit is when he possesses you some later date from salvation. I got saved on January 9th, 1983, and I didn't get baptized in the Holy Spirit until probably 1987. Because my wife was baptized in the Holy Spirit first, and I was jealous. How come she gets it? What's the matter with me? But you keep pressing in, and guess what? Suddenly.
That's right. Suddenly.
I think I shared this before. I was at the other church. I was praying with two other men, myself and Haywood Dan. You remember that? And we were just in the sanctuary. We were praying. And I was down on my face. I'm just praying. I'm calling out to God, you know. I wasn't praying for the Holy Spirit. I wasn't praying for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And these two brothers just came over. They didn't know what they're praying. They just laid their hands on me. And boom, I got filled with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
But this, the tongues of fire was over their head, abiding with them. But now he wanted to abide in them. He was abiding with them, and then they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Which means he went from abiding with them to abiding in them. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is available to every believer. That's the catch. Every believer. Tongues of fire are in this room waiting to be obtained. This room is filled with the Holy Spirit for every believer, but every believer is not filled with the Holy Spirit. And now the action of the disciple, after the Holy Spirit came in them, were empowered by an act of God. Listen to the difference. Before and after this event, Peter who just 2 months before even denied knowing Jesus, and he cowered before a servant girl. But after this act of God, we find him preaching Jesus boldly, unashamedly, and unafraid. Yes. And people cried out, as Pastor Brian was saying, what must we do to be saved?
Yes.
And 3,000 people
That's
got
right.
saved
That's
that
right.
day.
That's it. That's it.
A little servant girl scared him. Here he is, standing from an antagonistic crowd, boldly preaching the gospel. Verse 33 of that chapter says, and many signs and wonders were taking place. In chapter 3, Peter and John heal a lame beggar simply by saying, in the name of Jesus, walk. But Jesus told them, this shouldn't have surprised them, Jesus told them that this would happen when they received this act of God. Listen to this, our signature verse in John 14, 12. I tell you the truth, he who believes in me, the works I do, he will also do, and even greater works than these will he do. And most of us stop there, but here is the power behind these words. The next line. Because, this is going to be possible, because I go to the Father.
That's right.
Have you ever seen that in there?
Yes.
This is what makes the greater works available to us. This is what makes it possible, because I go to the Father. Listen to what he says in John 16. But now I am going to him who sent me. Remember, he said we'll be able to do what he had been doing and even greater things because he's going to the Father. And here he says, now I'm going to the Father. And then he says, for if I do not go away, the Holy Spirit will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. So it's the Holy Spirit that gives us the power to do the greater things. And on Pentecost, he sent the Holy Spirit to us, and Jesus said that he would take that power and that authority that was on him and put it on us. And here in Acts, back in chapter 1:8, he says, and you will receive power. And every time I say that word, I have to tell you what kind of power. Because I studied that word out in the Greek.
Kaboom.
And that word power is the word dunamis, which is supernatural dynamic dynamite power. Dunamis. And so it says you will receive dunamis power when the Holy Spirit's come on down. Why? Because Pentecost is an act of God. And I'm saying this for Randy because Randy likes it when I said, now listen to this. Listen to this. An act of God enables us to act like God.
Yes.
Yes.
Think of that. If we believe in the greater works, and we believe that we can do the things that Jesus was doing, even greater things, and most Christians don't believe that, but that's what it says. So an act of God enables us to act like God.
Yes.
Good word.
They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and they began to speak with other tongues. Now, I'm hurrying. Tongues is one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So many people get all tangled up and all upset over tongues and, oh, that's of the devil. How can it be of the devil when it says it's a gift of the Spirit?
Yes, right.
But we get all, you know why? Because you can't control it. So tongues is one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. It's found in 1 Corinthians 12. You can look it up. And many will tell me, well, yeah, but it's the least of the gifts. Okay. So? Yeah. But there's a connection between the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues. All the way through the Bible, there's a connection. Here, they were filled, and what happened? They spoke in tongues. Acts chapter 10:46, the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out. How did they know it? Because they heard them speaking in tongues. So what? This was the Holy Spirit. Why? Because I heard them speaking in tongues. Acts chapter 19, verse 6, when Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues. Now, I'm not sure, and maybe some of you Bible scholars will take issue with me, but I'm not sure that it's the only evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But I believe it's certainly the main evidence. And if it is the least of the gifts, you're never going to get a greater gift if God can't trust you with the least
of
the gifts?
That's it.
Amen?
That is it.
It is an act of God, but it's only made possible by the desire or the will of man.
Yes.
In other words, you have to want it.
That's it. Amen.
There's a lot of people are afraid of it. Afraid of the Holy Spirit. You have to want it. It's available to all believers. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians, listen to this. He says in 1 Corinthians 14, Paul says, I would like every one of you to speak in tongues. What did they do with that verse? I would like every one of you to speak in tongues. That's what the Apostle Paul said. And then he went on to say in 1 Corinthians 14, I thank God that I speak in tongues. He was from the South Corinth. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than y'all.
Amen.
That's it.
Can you imagine Paul submitting his resume to some of these churches today? Okay, yeah, you've been educated, you got this. You've been in jail?
Yeah.
All right, we can forgive that. But, what else you got? Well, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than y'all. As my words, if y'all speak in tongues, out the door you go.
That's it.
And now Paul was not one of the 120 that were in the upper room. So what does that tell us? It wasn't just for them. It's for all believers. It's
yes.
for you. It's available, and it's hovering over you, and you have to want it.
That's it. You got to want it. That's
so
it.
Coming to a close, he saturates us. He marinates us. He dominates us by immersing us into his dynamic presence. And that presence changed every one of those people in the upper room, and it will change you today. The discouraged will cheer up. The pickle post would sweeten up.
Right.
The gossipers will shut up.
Right.
The sleepers will wake up. The complacents will get fired up.
Right.
The putatos will jump up. The dishonest will fess up. The closed minded will open up. The conflicted will make up. The legalist will lighten up. And the religious will get shook up. And that will cause the devil to give up. You see, when the church gets revived, the world has a hope.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
When the church gets revived, sinners have a hope.
Yeah.
And that's why we cry out for an act of God.
Right.
Would you bow your heads? Self is an act of God. The Holy Spirit with you. An act of God causes two reactions. Some resist it, and some receive it. If you have never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he wants to do an act of God in your life today that will completely erase all your sins and wash it away. This act of God will make you stand before God spotless. Doesn't matter what you've done, how long you've done it. Today, your sins can be completely forgiven, not by coming to this altar, but by an act of God, receiving Jesus Christ. If you don't know Jesus Christ, would you come to this altar and say, I want to receive him today as my Lord and my Savior. In the Old Testament book of Joel, and in Acts chapter 2, God promised that in the last days, does anybody doubt that we're living in the last days? In the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. And Acts chapter 2, 39 says, the promise is for you. And it's for your children. It's an act of God. That it requires the will of man. And some in here have resisted the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Some have received it. Some have resisted it. If you want the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I want you to come up. You got to be a believer first. You have to know Christ. You want the baptism. Doesn't matter if you've been here before. I told you I've been there many times. But we're going to believe something happens today. Any more want the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Just come. Stand on my right hand side. Pastor Elena, could I have you pray over them for the baptism? May I pray for others on the other side, the left side here? If you're already a Christian, there are tongues of fire over you. So everybody over here, everybody down here right now, I want you to catch this. There's tongues of fire over you. That means it's available to you. God is ready. The prophetic word came through tongues today. God wants to dump it on you. The Holy Spirit is here. He abides right next to you, but he wants to fill you today. Pastor Elena and Pastor Brian are going to pray. Pastor Samuel, are you okay to come up? Or Pastor Samuel, you can help me over here on this side. For some of you others, in Acts chapter 4, a crisis came into the disciples' lives. They were baptized in Acts chapter 2 in the Holy Spirit. But now Acts chapter 4 comes along, something comes into their life, and they were again filled with the Holy Spirit. A refill. So if you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, but this corona thing has all but snuffed out the fire, come over here and we're going to pray that you would receive a refilling today. And those of you in your seats, you're going to hear things that you might not have heard before. You may see some things that are going to happen. Come on, I want you to pray with power. I want everybody, ministers, pray with power.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Acts chapter 2. The Lord commanded us to stop the fire. And we pray for the fire of God. We pray for the fire of God. Verse 5. Gary, fire of God, we pray out now, Jesus. If you will take control, Lord, take control. Let my son down of our home to our side. Free love. Oh, God, we do it. Let my son down of our home. Let my son down of our home. Let my son down of our home. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
You guys don't want the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you can't do it with your mouth closed.
Cry out. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Begin to worship. Begin to worship.
Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Hallelujah, Father. Let it come from heaven, O Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Suddenly, let the suddenly of God come right now. The suddenly of God. In your heart, in your being, just speak it out. Speak it out.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
That restriction that you're feeling, let the Holy Ghost baptize him and let him be free right now. Free. Let him be free, Father. Lord, to pray in tongues, Father. To pray in a heavenly language that he's never known. Hallelujah. And I thank you that you give them the baptism of the Holy Ghost as a building block, Father. Lord, that he goes higher, goes deeper, Father. Deeper, Lord.
Come on, somebody's got a prophetic word.
It's Tim's gift, Father.
Let it We're here. We got
let
it.
Let it be to him, Father. Lord, let him go after it. Let him go after it.
And it shall be in the last days, says God, that I will pour forth of my spirit on all mankind. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my bondslaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth of my spirit. And they shall prophesy, and I will grant wonders in the sky above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood, before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come. And it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Hallelujah. Come on, somebody today has a message in tongues. If the Lord's laying that on your heart, I want you to speak it out, message in tongues. Come on, it doesn't matter how short it is, just obey the Holy Spirit today.
Listen, let this not be just a one-time experience.
The fire is in you. You bring it next week. God bless you.
Thank you.